Center Goa. The International Center Goa is a forum which brings together scholars, thinkers, academics, achievers, sociologists, industrialists, and creative people from India and around the world to look at the larger issues before India and to develop ideas and solutions for handling them. Over the years, we have facilitated study and dialogue on a range of issues, including economic development, health, education, jurisprudence, international affairs, environment, politics, gender equality, etc. The center seeks to anticipate emerging trends and problems, to promote a better understanding and to put topical issues in their correct perspective towards the growth of a harmonious and integrated society. Hence, we are very delighted to have a talk on Bharatiyata today. India is a vast country of 1.4 billion people, constituting 17.5% of the world's population. We are a country made of diverse people in terms of ethnicity, language, food and cuisine, habitat, religion, caste, tribes, etc. Indeed, we Indians have multiple identities. Yet, we are all bound together by a common bond of being descendants of one of the world's oldest civilizations that is more than 5,000 years old. It is this common bond which is the essence of Bharatiyata. We are indeed privileged to have Shri Arif Khan deliver a talk on the subject of Bharatiyata. Shri Arif ji is a scholar of Hindu scriptures, including the Mahabharata, Ramayana, and the Vedas in particular, and Indian civilization as a whole. Likewise, Shri Arif ji is also an expert on Islam and is actively involved in writing articles and columns related to Islam and Sufism. He is the author of the best-selling book, Text and Context, Quran and Contemporary Challenges. The articles in the book provide a comprehensive understanding of the message, spirit and essence of the Quran. Shri Arif ji was educated at Jamia Millia School, Delhi, Aligarh Muslim University, Aligarh, and at Shia College, Lucknow University. He started his political career at a young age. He was president of Aligarh Muslim University Students Union in 1971-72 and was elected to the Legislative Assembly of Uttar Pradesh in 1977 at the young age of 26. He was elected to the Lok Sabha for the first time in 1980 and has been MP during the 1980s and 90s. He held ministerial responsibilities from 1984 to 1990, including the portfolios of agriculture, industry, company affairs, home affairs, civil aviation, and energy. Finally, I hope you find this talk by Shri Arif ji very enlightening and helps your understanding of Bharatiyata. I now request Honorable Governor Shri Arif Mohammad Khan ji to deliver his address. Thank you.
In fact, our civilization should be described as knowledge civilization. We were the hub. We attracted scholars from all over the country, from many parts of the world. In fact, our thought leaders, they had envisioned India to be a place where people, scholars, will come to understand, study and understand not only India, but to understand and study their own traditions and their own culture. They will come to India. What does that mean? That we will have scholars of such repute that a European will come to study about Europe to India, or an Arab will come to India. Etat desha parshu tasya sakashadha graj anmana swam swam charitram shikcheram prithviyam sarvam anam. This is what our thought leaders had envisaged, the role for India. But Swami Ranganath Nandaji says that there is no doubt that we were knowledge civilization. But unfortunately, during the period of decline and fall, we paid lip service. And he quotes from Srimad Bhagavat to highlight the point which he is making there. Saraswati Gyan Kalv Yatha Sati. A scholar who confines knowledge which he has acquired, she has acquired within herself and does not share with others, then that scholar is not a devotee of Saraswati, he is a villain of Saraswati. So according to Swami Ranganathananda, we became weak, our society became vulnerable because we start keeping knowledge from masses. We denied access to knowledge. And Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore has said it so beautifully. He says, India cannot attain true independence unless it is recognized that her foundation is in mind, which with its diverse powers and confidence in those powers goes on all the time creating Swaraj for itself. Because when you build a civilization based on knowledge, a civilization based on material progress, there can be limits. But a civilization based on knowledge, every day you have to explore new areas. You have to continue. I mean, it's an always ongoing task. And I would again like to quote Gurudev. He said, I love India. Not because I cultivate the idolatry of geography. Not because I have had the good fortune to be born in her soil. But because she has, through tumultuous ages, saved the living words which shoot from the illuminated consciousness of her children. Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma, Shantam, Shivam, Advaitam. The peace which India envisions is not a negative concept, nor a mechanical adjustment. This peace is in goodness, Shivam. This peace is in perfect unity, integration of personality. That is Advaitam. In fact, the highest ideal of human life, according to our ancient thought leaders, is integration of personality, which reconciles an individual with his own self, with the society, and if you believe with the Supreme Being. This civilization does not insist it is necessary to believe. You believe in yourself, that is enough. But integration of personality. Why? Because of all the, and please do not think even for a moment that I am criticizing any other civilization. No. Every civilization, they grow according to their own genius. I am talking about our civilization, not even trying to compare with others, but only as a subject matter of history. These civilizations world over were defined either by the color of the skin, the race you belong to, the language which you speak, or mostly just before and during the medieval period, by the faith tradition. how you express, if you are a believer, then how you express your devotion to the deity in which you believe. They became the defining paradigm of various civilizations. India, our thought leaders, whom we call rishis or munis, they also chose a defining paradigm. But it was not an exclusive characteristic like race, color, language, because if it is defined by race, then all other people will be excluded. Similar is the case with language, similar is the case with faith tradition. What the Indian thought leaders did, they defined Indian culture, Indian civilization through Atma, the soul. Aham Brahmasmi Tattvamasi. Many a times we hear that India was politically fragmented. It was. Even in 1947, there were more than 500, if I remember correctly, 567 states. It was no easy task to integrate them into one union, to make them merge with the Indian Union. Even the Indian Union itself was so full of, you leave the princely states outside. The rest of India, which was under the British, was so full of diversities. And it has been rightly said that unless you understand the culture, you can't understand culture of a people, you can't understand their politics. India was deeply, deeply fragmented politically. But no one denies, and no one can deny, that India was culturally and spiritually one entity. Maybe we were not, because the political unity was not there and the area is so large, maybe we were not even aware of it. But a young man, difficult to say even whether he had reached that age where he could have been described as man, he was still a boy, young. A young boy from Kerala goes on this pilgrimage. He creates 4 mutts in different parts of the country. We often hear that Adi Shankaracharya, by establishing these mutts, he created the cultural and spiritual unity of India. I do not know what was the size of the building of those mutts, but buildings do not bring about unity. Ideas bring about unity. What Shankaracharya did, he chose one Mahavakya from one Veda and gave it to one mutt. Another Mahavakya from another Veda to another mutt. And all 4 Mahavakyas which he selected from the Vedas, which he gave to 4 different mutts, they all mean the same thing. Aham Brahmasmi Tattvamasi Pragyanam Brahma I am Atma Brahma, made everyone aware that we are spiritually interlinked. Swami Vivekananda has so beautifully said, he said, what is the purpose of life? You want to live happily, pursuit of happiness? He said Indian tradition does not endorse it. The purpose of life is not pursuit of happiness. Purpose of life is pursuit of knowledge. Tapa swadhyaya nirita. Ever devoted to this, to the pursuit of knowledge. And then the question arises, what is the purpose of knowledge? Then he replies that the purpose of knowledge is that even the children of the same parents, they do not look similar. So purpose of knowledge is to develop the ability, the capability, the capacity to see the underlying unity, the apparent diversity, underlying the apparent diversity. Everyone looks different. Everyone has different thinking. But underlying that, there is a strong undercurrent of unity. And that is why the integration of personality has been accepted to be one of the highest aim, idea of human life according to Indian tradition. So this, and the fact is that I do not want to go back to where what Swami Ranganath Nandaji has said, that a period has passed in which we became unfamiliar with our own ethos. We became unfamiliar with our own traditions. It was because our culture and civilization was defined by Atma. Therefore, unlike world over, the other means who does not speak the same language as I speak, who does not worship in the same manner as I do, whose color of the skin is not the same as mine. The other always created apprehensions in the mind of the people of any area. But India was one place which always, we always believed. Earlier I said that our civilizational journey started with the recognition that diversity is the law of nature. The diversity does not discomfit us. Rather, we believed firmly. The Rig Veda declared, and this is the, that is the first quote, Ekam Sad Vipra Bahuda Vadanti. The truth is one. One and one only. But those who seek the truth, those who realize the truth, those who experience the truth, they describe it variously. We always believed that one single interpretation of reality cannot be imposed on everybody. We always believed in the freedom of spirit. Tiyaj dekam kul syarthe, gram syarthe, kulam teje, gramam janpat syarthe, atmarthe, prithvi teje. I should be ready to sacrifice myself for the family. The family for my village. The village for my district. District for my state. State for my country. But as far as the your freedom of conscience, freedom of spirit is concerned, then you should be ready to renounce even the whole world, but uphold that freedom of spirit. India always believed in that. We had very robust, very sturdy belief in the integration of the personality and at the same time in the freedom of spirit. To my mind, these are the essential features or foundational virtues of Bhartiyata. Where I do not feel uncomfortable in the company of those who are different from me. I have the confidence to interact with anybody without losing my own moorings. Then a universal vision, with that again is already crossed 30 minutes, sorry. We always had, at a time when our own country was politically fragmented, when hardly any means of effective communication were available, people had to walk on feet. Even at that point of time, our thought leaders had a universal vision. Ayam nich paro veti garna lakhu cheta sam udar charita naam tu vasudev kutumbka samudra paryantaya prithviya ek raj vishvam vishnu. We saw because again, go back to that spiritual interconnectedness. How come we became unfamiliar with our own ethos, our own way? Look today in the world, last 100-150 years, outstretch it at few more decades. The whole world has become pluralistic or is in the process of becoming pluralistic. But this development is not very old. India has been pluralistic. We not only accepted diversity as law of nature, our thought leaders exhorted us to be respectful for the diversity. In Jain Darshan, there suddenly came to my mind, there's a beautiful, beautiful story. Anekantvat, diversity, is one of the basic principles of Jainism. In Sanatan, the word used is Bahuda. In Jainism, they have used word Anekantvad, Siyadvad, some more words. But there is a beautiful anecdote which highlights that large-heartedness, breadth of mind. Acharya Hemchandra was a very prominent Jain Muni. And because of his erudition and learning, the ruler of the that part of Gujarat where he lived, he developed a special liking for him. And he will, most of the occasions he would call him to the court and show great respect to him, which made other scholars in the court jealous of Acharya Hemchand. On one occasion he decided, Raja Kumarpal, name of the Raja was Kumarpal, Raja decided to go on pilgrimage to Dwarka. Now these scholars of his court, they were very happy that Acharya Hemchandra is Jain. If he, Raja Kumarpal will perform all the rituals, including Aarti, and he is insisting that Acharya Hemchand should accompany him, and he will expect him also to perform the same rituals, which are not exactly in accord with the Jain tenets. So either it will be embracement for him or he will lose respect. Embracement, if he does it, then he will do something which his own tradition does not allow. And if he does it, then his own crisis. If he does not do it, then he will lose affection of the of Raja Kumarpal. So as they thought, it happened exactly on the same lines. After performing the aarti, Kumarpal handed over the tray, thali, to Acharya Hemchand. Acharya Hemchand very respectfully took the aarti in his hand and he said, Bhav Bijankur Janna Raga Diya Chema Pagutu Yas Brahma Vishnu Vaharo Jinova Namastas. He said, I am not bothered whether the name is Brahma or Vishnu or Hari or Jin, whatever name, I pay my salutes to that Vitradatma. In Sanatana tradition, it has been repeatedly said, Janardhanova, Maheshwarova, you take Akashat Patitam Toye, Yatha Gachati Sagar, Sarva Deva Namaskara, Keshavam Priti Gachati. Like every drop which falls from the skies rushes towards ocean, similarly, you pay obeisance to any name of your choice of the God. But whatever devotion you express, ultimately it reaches that one who cannot be given any name, who is kya hai, agrahiyam, alakshanam, achintayam, avyapadeshiyam, ekatma, pirtiya yasaram, pirpanchopashamam. It is not possible to describe that Supreme Being. So basically, Bhartiyata, if I sum up the whole thing, then it means that we respect, accept diversity. We do not feel uncomfortable in the company for us because we believe that we are all the other people may think otherwise, but an Indian, he knows that the life which an Indian is living is not the only life. Your faith in karma leads to many lives. And I would like to conclude with an anecdote which comes from Anand Ramayana. An I think which sums up beautifully what Bhaktiyata stands for. After Bhagavan Ram came back to Ayodhya, established his rule, and everybody was happy. Ram Raj. A dog comes to his court and complains to him that he has been hurt without reason by so and so. An inquiry was ordered immediately, and it was found that the allegation of the dog was absolutely right. And this man who had hurt the dog was a temple priest. So Bhagavan Ram asked the dog that I would like to know from you what punishment should be given to this man, because your complaint, whatever you have said, is right. He said, he is an ordinary priest in the temple. I want him to be promoted and be made as head priest. Then everybody in the court laughed and they asked him, have you come here to get him punished, or you have come here to get him promoted? He said, you are all human beings, but your Atma is not Chaitanya. I did something nasty in my last birth. Because of that, I am what I am today. But I still have, my merits are so many that I still have Chaitanya Atma. I know what I was in my earlier birth. I know what I was before that. And in my last birth, I was the head priest of a temple. And because I was head priest, therefore I had no accountability. And when you have no accountability, then you are likely to do stupid things. So what is this punishment? This punishment is very small. I have received the punishment that despite having lived on so many merits, because of some one act, I have to live this life of dog. That is no punishment if he is demoted as a priest. I want him to become head priest. Nobody will be able to stop him from committing things which will land him in the same situation as today I have landed. And that will be the real punishment. So if we take all these things into consideration, the one thing, if we really believe in these ideas, if we uphold these ideas, if we internalize these principles, if we translate them into action, then no one can dare step on the feet of the other person. Because I know that my culture tells me that what goes around comes around. And that is why I feel so confident. India is now being recognized as the emerging power all over the world. But howsoever powerful and mighty India becomes, nobody in the world will feel apprehensive. Nobody in the world will have any feeling of any threat from us. Because our cultural our cultural values do not allow us to trespass into another sanctuary. If you remember Prime Minister last 15th August, he talked about five principles, and one of them, to my mind, the important one, is that he talked about our cultural legacy. We should try to become more aware, more familiar of the great legacy which we have. But it is absolutely fatal to rest in the consciousness of what we have inherited. We need to build on our inheritance and move towards new achievements. Thank you very much. Loka samasta sukhino bhavantu. Jai Hind.